Let me start off with a quote of a Brazilian writer, a writer that I really admire. His name is Paulo Coelho. And what he says here is, if you think adventure is dangerous, then try routine, it's lethal. And when I read this, or when I read this, I immediately go back to evolution theories like what Darwin has taught us, that some species are more successful in development than other species. And what really makes species successful that survive for a long time is their ability to adapt to new situations. These species, they take that adventure, although it's dangerous, but they survive. The species that don't adapt, they extinct. So therefore, this morning my son was crying because I stole his little ducky. And he didn't understand I needed that to bring that point across. Let's assume this duck is actually a Labrador duck. And the Labrador duck lives in North America on the East Coast. And this duck, for thousands, hundred thousands of years, has been eating mussels. That's the only thing this duck eats. Doesn't care about any other food. And now, in a declining mussel population in the northern part the eastern part of Americas, this duck is getting extinct. And all the sisters and brothers of this duck around the globe have been transforming themselves into eating multiple kind of food, and they have survived. Now, in a sense, your company, or we as individuals, we as leaders of the industry, we as citizens of this world, we're also eating mussels. We are, and our mussels, you could call our water, oil, energy in general. And when you look at the population in this world, we're now at 7 billion population. It took us 1850 years to come to the first billion. Guess how many years it took us to build the last billion, from 6 billion to 7 billion? It took us only 12 years. That's how fast this population in the world is growing, exponentially. And if you look at the middle class of the world right now, compared to the middle class in 2030, that middle class will grow by three times. And we all know that the middle class is the one that consumes the most. So imagine that middle class, all the resources that middle class will need to make their cars, to build their houses, to provide the energy that they need. So we will be living in a world where those resources start to be scarce, just like the mussels for this little ducky. So transformation, our way to transform, will be like the new normal in a world where change is the only constant. And we need to transform on multiple levels, on micro level up to macro level. We as individuals play a role to transform ourselves, to do more with our brain power. We as leaders of the industry need to be more to guide our companies to become more productive and make better use of all the resources that we have. And we as citizens of the world have a certain stewardship towards this, towards the world, and the government plays a big role in that.
In part one, Kurt made clear that it's not the largest organizations that survive, nor the most diversified, but the ones most responsive to changing conditions. In the second part, Kurt will discuss what makes some organizations more successful than others when it comes to transforming themselves. He will use a framework from his book, 5 Steps to Customer Centricity. Successful organizations start with a clear recognition of what needs to be transformed.
So, companies that make a transformation, they look at basically 5 things. And either a transformation is there to increase revenues. That will be a sales or marketing transformation, or a transformation to increase your go-to-market, you improve your go-to-market strategy or process. Then there are all kinds of transformations around cost of goods sold. So how do we make sure that we serve a customer in a cheaper way? So how do we make sure that we handle telephone calls of customers into our company in a better way, for example, or with less people, with less cost, without impacting the service level to the customer? The third one here is reducing the cost of sales and general and administrative expenses. So this is IT costs, for example, are part of that, or your finance costs, or your HR costs. So how all the supporting functionalities that don't link directly to a customer output, but are there to manage the company itself, how can you lower those expenses? The fourth one here is, how can we improve asset utilization? So I have machineries, I have pipelines, I have a harbor. How do I make sure that I make best use of those assets so that more revenue comes from those assets? So we just had a conversation here about the taxi company in Singapore, and research shows that 60% of the taxis is unutilized at any moment in time. That's not making very good use of those cars. What if we can improve that to 65% or 70%? I mean, that would mean a lot of additional value to Comfort Delgro in this case. But it would also reduce the impact on our environment. And then the last one here is reducing working capital. And reducing working capital is really how to free up cash flow, how to make sure that customers pay you faster and you pay your vendor slower, that is, or later. That are some strategies that companies are taking for. You can reduce your cost of goods sold, but you cannot let that have impact in any way on your customers, because they will walk away if you start to serve them in the way they your competitors are serving them. So what you want, any transformation starts with the customer in mind, has a customer centricity core. And what it really does, if you focus around your customer, they will buy more, recommend to others. Your cost to serve those customers is lower, because happy customers, or customers that will be delivered a good customer experience, they complain less. They call less into your call centers. They will be more likely to pay a premium for your products. They also pay faster and they stay, and that is the definition of loyalty. So, transformation start with a customer in mind, have an aspect of, all have a linkage into operational KPIs, and need to be linked finally to a larger goal, and that is shareholder value. Now, the prospects of business transformation are great. Simon talked about it already, this Chinese water company, they improved their bottom line 5% by transforming their whole business and making improvements in their supply chain. And they cut out 35% of their supply chain costs with a transformation. So imagine that. Imagine what that does to the competitiveness of this company, where no other company with that skill will be able to do that. So they have now certainly much more flexibility in the pricing of their products. They can go into markets where they previously were not able to go into. But success doesn't come granted. Business transformations have a certain risk. And I go back to the quote in the beginning of Paulo Coelho. There is a danger in this adventure. And the danger is very well illustrated by a research that was done by McKinsey. McKinsey looked at 5,500 huge business transformations. Business transformation that cost more than $15 million each. And they start to analyze each of them. And they find out that 45% of those large transformations are actually going over the budget that was predicted up front. 7% of those business transformations go over time. Total value that was predicted up front, only 44% gets realized. 56% companies leave on the table. And so obviously in business transformation, there's a lot of value leakage. creating a business case before you start a transformation and measure against that business case along the way and see if the predicted value is also realized. So let me talk about four pillars of a successful business transformation. And in 2012, I published this book, Five Steps to Customer Centricity. And I talk a lot about these, about business transformations and how business transformations that are focused around the customer will help a business to transform in the right way, very successfully. So I took one of the frameworks that I introduced in my book to explain what are those four pillars that make sure that your transformations are on budget, on time, but most important of all, on value. The first one here is vision. So it starts with a vision. If you don't know what you're transforming towards and you cannot explain it in a few words, explain it to all your employees and your shareholders and your suppliers, you're going to have a hard time. And your vision starts with a lot of research, et cetera, but it needs to be condensed in something simple, something that people can understand and can start to talk about as well and will carry themselves as if it was their own vision. The second one here is targets. And target setting for value-driven business transformation is probably the most important aspect of the whole transformation itself. Targets need to be set on three different levels. So you have your you have the highest level, the financial financial metrics. Like how much you're going to impact your return on invested capital, how much working capital are you going to save, or how much cost are you going to reduce. The second box, or the second part of metrics that need to be introduced into a transformation are operational metrics. So you have processes that run for a few days, and maybe you want to reduce the process. SAP is obviously a lot involved with customers that close their books in 15 days, for example, and they want to reduce it to 10 days. Those are typical operational KPIs, and that can be part of your transformation. The third metric that you really need to put into your target setting is customer KPIs. You're going to measure how your customer is going to react on the changes that you are that you're making inside your processes, because if you don't put that in and you just leave it at the operational level and a financial level, you'll never get the outside view. And you may think that everything, that your whole transformation is successful because you're reducing some times here, or you're making sure that people pick up calls faster. But if the customer doesn't realize that we make that change, what's the purpose? Yeah. And if they don't realize it, you will never get your anticipated results back. And often, what a customer is saying is immediately. You can immediately get that feedback loop in your organization, where financial results may have a certain lag after you have changed something in your organization. And the last one would be employee feedback or employee KPIs. How is this change going to affect the engagement of my people in my company? And that is very important, because it's the employees who have to carry the change and have to make it a success or a failure. The third pillar here is measurements. So once you've set KPIs, you need to make sure that there's a feedback loop into the organization at any time. Because a lot of people will be trying things. I do this project as part of the transformation, and somebody else trying another project. You want to give them feedback how successful those little steps are, so that they can start to adjust their steps in time. Not we change for a year and then we see how well we have done. And number four is governance. And governance is where you manage the change, where you manage the risk, and where you put different stakeholders from within your company, you put them together on a regular basis, and you have them discuss on where they are in the transformation and what they're gonna change in their course to make sure that they get to the targets that were set.
In part two, Kurt explained how the five steps to customer centricity can be used to deliver transformations on time, on budget, and on value. In the last part, he will tell us more on value management, the most critical capability of a company when it comes to business transformations, and a call to action to his audience.
As I said, we work with 100,000 customers around the globe. Here in Singapore, we have SAP has 1,100 customers running on SAP, and we do a lot of research. We really engage our customers in how transformational work was done. We measure before they start a transformation, how fast certain processes run or how much money they spend on certain departments. And then we measure 1 year, 2 years afterwards as well to make sure that we start to learn how effective certain transformations was. But what we have also seen is that there's a huge difference between business transformations that were run with value management, the four pillars that I just described. Large transformation where value management played a key role versus transformations where value management played hardly a role. And the difference are huge. So, and here's some quantitative. So transformations that start with value management and put more effort in the start of the business transformation to define the right targets and to build some measurements and to build in the governance are 2 times as likely to be on time. They are 1.9 times more likely to be within budget. And our research shows that those projects, they deliver on average 1.6 times the value of projects that are where value management doesn't play a role. I start off with a quote. I'll finish with a short story, and the story is as follows: There is a man, and he takes a stroll along the beach. He's an older man, and in the far he sees a lady, or he sees a silhouette of a lady, and she's dancing. So it grabs his attention, and he walks towards her. And when he moves closer, he sees that the lady's not dancing, but actually she's throwing something into the sea. And so he goes up to her, and because his interest grows and grows, and he says, "Hey, what are you doing?" She says, "Yeah, I have here a bunch of starfish, and I'm throwing them back in the sea because on the shore they're here lying and they're dying in the soaring heat of the sun." And the man thinks it's quite noble, but then he looks down the beach and he sees millions of these starfish lying there. And he said, "Do you really know what you're doing? Because there are a million out here. They will, you know, whatever you do, they will all die." And then the lady replies, "That may be true, but at least I'm saving this one." Moral of the story here is that we as individuals can play a role to make large things happen. And we cannot pretend that we on our own can solve the scarceness of resources in our own lifetime. But what we as individuals can do, make ourselves more productive, make the companies that you're leading more productive, and as companies combined and as citizens of this world, we're going to make sure that we increase the productivity of all different organisms in this world so much that we make the impact less and we create a world where that is livable for many generations. Thank you.